Hi, back for another Back Porch Proverbs, and we're in Proverbs 13, and we're going to try to do two verses today, 6 and 7, partly because 6 is really short. It's not very long either. Righteousness guards him whose way is blameless, but sin overthrows the wicked. So we've just, in the verse before, talked about what righteous is, and that's those who seek after the will of God, and wicked is those whose intent and purpose is to destroy and do the opposite of what the will of God would be. So a righteous man guards. Okay, now what do you think about guarding? I'll never forget it. Years and years ago, I was watching some little kids play upwards basketball, and their names were Josh and Brad. Cute little boys, and they're probably out of college now. But somehow somebody had convinced them that they were guarding each other, and they were from the opposite teams, but they knew each other. They went to school together. So the basketball game is going on the other end of the court, but these two little boys are guarding each other, and they're way down on the other court. They're looking at each other, and they're going like this, and someone told them, you guys got to guard each other. And the ball game was way on the other side of the court, but they were guarding each other. They weren't going to let them anywhere far away from where they thought they should be, and that's what guards are. Guards have boundaries, and the righteous has a boundary. This way is blameless. Now, I'm pretty confident that if you were like me when you were younger, you got blamed for things you didn't do. I was this cute little innocent kid that never did anything wrong. And I didn't get blamed a lot because I was the youngest. And some of my older siblings seemed to think that I should have been blamed more because it was my fault. We will never know because our parents are both dead, and so it doesn't really matter, except they hold a grudge and I'm still the cute little girl. But blameless is something we want. We want to be blameless. We don't want it to be our fault. Of course, unless we want the credit for something that's really good or we're wicked. Righteous people don't want to be blamed for something. And it's interesting because when you say to somebody, did somebody do this? It seems like we all go, oh, not my fault. I didn't do it. Wasn't there. We don't want to be blamed because usually with blame comes a consequence, and we don't want consequences. But sin overthrows the wicked. So sin is a transgression of God's law. And you can go back to the Ten Commandments. But sin is basically not treating others better than ourselves. It's insulting God's creation. It's hurting people, hurting hearts. It is taking ourselves and making ourselves God. The moral laws that God set out, basically Jesus reduced it to two, love the Lord your God with all your heart. You don't have other idols. Things aren't more important than God. You use God's name as something to be revered, not to be sweared. There's things about God and his nature that we worship. We don't belittle them. And then love your neighbor as yourself. So a lot of sin could be avoided in the last 6-10 commandments basically are the sins we do against other people. We don't honor the people that need honor. We envy, we steal, we covet, we have misappropriated behavior with other people. That's sin. And sin overthrows the wicked. So if you are wicked, if you are intentionally planning and harming people and doing whatever bad things you can do to people, eventually the things you are doing will overtake you. That's a promise. Sin overthrows the wicked. Now, what is sin? And we've talked about it, but what is overthrows? You ever played King in the Hill? We used to play chicken fights, and two people that you wanted to be on the person's back with chicken fights. And in my growing up, it was Mike Clement or Art Dice or Mike Gibson. There was three of them because they were going to win. If you were on their back for a chicken fight, a little kid got up on an older person's back, hopefully with strong legs, and then you'd go around and you'd try to pull the other people off the other people's backs. And it was mostly the little kids up on the backs. But if you did anything with those three men, football, baseball, whatever, they were going to win. And you want to be on a team with someone who's going to be the winner, the overthrower. You don't want to be on the losing team. And so if you're going to overthrow something, you are going to win. You're going to be over control, be preside, have power over whatever that thing is. That's what overthrowing is. Sometimes I have a really, really, really good idea, and my husband overthrows my idea. His idea takes precedent over my idea. Now, most of them times they were probably poor ideas. But if I have a good one, then I overthrow his idea. But it's not a matter of who's the more powerful. It's what's the better idea. And overthrowing takes the top step. It becomes the power. So sin becomes the power over the wicked that the wicked intended to control to someone else. So what does it say? It says that people who seek after God have boundaries. And when you have boundaries, you're not going to be blamed for things that are past the boundaries. If you don't run in the ditch, you're not going to get the poison ivy in the ditch. Does that make sense? Stay in the road. There's your boundaries. Your guard, you have a boundary. And you're going to not have poison ivy, and you're not going to be blamed for having poison ivy on you because you didn't go past the boundaries. But sin, which is taking God's law and perverting it, is going to overcome, be the power over the one who's wicked. So what doesn't it say? It doesn't say that just because you're righteous, you're never going to be blamed for things. And just because you're wicked doesn't mean you'll always have things go bad against you, because a lot of times wicked people prevail. And we go, but that's not fair. And in Proverbs, it says the sin overthrows the wicked, and it seems like the wicked are overthrowing everybody. But remember, it's the pattern. Eventually, the wicked will be overthrown by sin. So what does Jesus fit in? Well, Jesus fits in on John 3:7, he who does what is right is righteous, just as he, Jesus, is righteous. Who do you want to be like? Who's going to bring us to that blameless state? It's the righteousness of Christ. So then verse 7, quickly. One pretends to be rich, yet has nothing. Another pretends to be poor, yet has great wealth. What do you do when you pretend? Oh, we pretended all the time when we were kids. We would be on yachts traveling around the world, and actually the yacht was just an old wagon axle out in the weeds. Rich? Accumulation of great things. Now, to me, riches means something totally different than a lot of other people, because I don't care for clothes necessarily. I need to be dressed. I don't really care. So my riches are not in my clothing. But God has given us incredible riches in a lake house, in a farm, in relationships, in children. I don't know if I'd call the dogs rich, but we have riches. Riches is kind of what is important to you in a hierarchy. So one who pretends to be rich has nothing. So if you pretend that you have 4 kids and 3 dogs and 16 cars, and you pretend, eventually someone's going to come to your house and ask how the kids are, and there aren't any, or ask if they could borrow a car, and there isn't any. Yeah, most of our life we've had more than one car, and it's been the car that people get to drive when they need a car. And the old green Escort went all over the place. We called it the Frog. Because you could loan them out. We were blessed. But people who pretend to have things and don't, they have nothing. They don't even have good friends, because after a while, people don't know if they're pretending or real. And there's something about being rich that people want to be rich, because they think that's where our value is. The next part of that verse is another pretends to be poor yet has great wealth. Okay, now I don't necessarily pretend to be poor, but the pretend part is you don't put pretenses that you're something else. You're not telling people you're rich like the other one. You just live as if you aren't. So one is living as if they are, but they're not. One is living as if they are not, but they are, and yet has great wealth. Our wealth is not in what we have. Our wealth is who we are and who Christ has made us to be. So get the pretending out of the way. What does it basically say? What does it mean? It says that the great pretender, go back to the Statler brothers, pretenders deceive people. And you've heard of all the millionaires that died, and they thought, everyone thought they were poor, and they were very, very wealthy. Because there's something about people treat you different if they know you have stuff, have money. So he who pretends to just be normal. He has great wealth because his value is not in what he has. And Philippians reminds us of that. I know how to be brought low and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger and abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. I know how to. I know how to pretend. I know how to have wealth and not flaunt it. I know how to have nothing and not beg off other people. I've learned that I can do all things because Christ gives me the ability to wherever I'm at, that I can rest in who I am, not who I pretend to be. Have a great one.